like a leaker curl, so I can keep
it. Point it towards them.
It's on maximum.
Maximum?
Speaker ठीक नहीं है।
Anyways, my TV बोल रहा था। I can speak louder.
There is.
Move the nearer.
You have to pull right up the chair up.
So, this is really awkward, but I'll give it a shot. Otherwise, I might just give up in the middle. What I wanted to talk about is Sikhi and everyday life. One thing I've noticed is a lot of times we talk about theoretical things, and Sikhi is quite the opposite. Sikhi isn't theoretical, it's very practical. Next slide. But before I start, I wanted to do a little bit of a disclaimer. When I'm standing up here, it's a really odd dynamic. It seems as though I know something that all of you don't, and I'm here to teach you. And really, I don't believe in the lecture format. I believe in a Sangat discussion format. I don't really like this. And I want to let you know that these are my own views. It's just what I think, and I could be wrong. The reason I'm telling you this is because I think it's right, but I could very well be wrong. So if you think I'm wrong, feel free to challenge me on anything. And the other thing is, some of the things I say, I don't intend for this to happen, but it may happen. It may offend somebody. Or might make someone feel uncomfortable. And that's, once again, not my intention. But one thing someone once said to me is that when you feel uncomfortable, sometimes that's the best opportunity to grow. Sometimes it's a good opportunity to either solidify your own beliefs or maybe learn something new. So, just throwing that out there right now. Next slide. So, I'm starting off with who is a Sikh. But maybe the appropriate place to start with would have been why Sikhi, right? I mean, there's a lot of things we can be doing in life. Why Sikhi? And that's a whole presentation to itself. But briefly speaking, Sikhi guarantees something. Guru Sahib says, you follow my path, you follow this path, and every blessing will be yours. Happiness, contentment. Guru Sahib even uses the term Anand Karna, which means extreme bliss. Not just Anand, but Karna, like too much. So that's what Sikhi has to offer. But who is a Sikh? How can we follow Sikhi? Guru Sahib actually gives you, when you shak amrit, sometimes the Panch Pyare actually sing this to you before you are accepted or before you make your decision whether you really want to do this. There's a shabd that says, Jau to prem khelan ka jau, sir tar tali gali meri aao. It means that if you want to play the game of love, then step onto my path with your head held on your hands. What does that mean? It means being willing to make a sacrifice, means willing to accept that my head, what I think is right and wrong, what I think is good for me, may not necessarily be true. So I'm going to listen to what Guruji has to say. And then, what does Guru Sahib says to finish this sloka? He says, Et marg pair tarijay, sir dijay, kaan na kijay. And he says that once you've stepped onto this path, and it's a big commitment, it's not a small commitment that you take lightly. Once you've stepped onto this path, then don't worry about what anyone else has to think. Which makes sense, because Sikhi is different. Sikhi is not what everyone else is doing. And when you do something different, when you go off the beaten track, people are going to go, what are you doing? That's weird. People are going to question you. But Guru Sahib is telling you from the outset, don't worry about that. Make sure that you're firm within your own convictions. So, where does that really, what's the next step? That's another shabd I wanted to talk to you. And I'm going to be relying as much as possible on shabds and Gurbani, because it doesn't matter what I have to say. It really matters what Guru Sahib has to say about Gurbani, what Guru Sahib has to say about Sikhi. So Guru Sahib is now saying, what is a Sikh? So Sikh, Sakha Banda Pahapai. That this is my friend, this is my Sikh. Je Gur Ke Paane Vich Aave. Who comes into the will of the Guru. Not just calling yourself a Sikh, but actually coming into what Guru Sahib wants you to do. Labels are something that Guru Nanak rejected a long time ago. It doesn't matter if you call yourself a Sikh. It really matters what you do. So Guru Sahib says, Gur Ke Paane Vich Aave. Comes into the will of the Guru. Apne paane jo challe paai, vichhad chota khaave. So if you're walking this path, And apne paane, that means your own will. If you're coming into this path and you decide you're going to follow your own will, Guru Sahib is already telling you, vichhad chotaan khaave, that you're going to fall off the path and you're going to hurt yourself. You're going to be disappointed. Because obviously, if you came onto this path and you decided to follow Sikhi, it was a commitment, right? And if you don't accomplish something after you make a commitment, if you give something of yourself into making a decision and then you don't get a result, you feel disappointed. So Guru Sahib is already warning you that make sure you follow what Sikhi is all about. Otherwise, if you're going to follow your own mat, your own mind, then you're probably going to be separated from me in this path and you're going to hurt yourself. And then Guru Sahib finishes by saying, Bin Satgur, Sukh Kade Na Paave Pai. So he's saying, brother, without Satguru, you're never going to find happiness. Fir pachotave, and you're going to regret it. Pachotavana means to regret. You're going to regret it. This is something that some people realize in this life, some people might realize in several lives, some people realize now, some people might realize later on. But the only true secret to happiness is spirituality. That inner happiness, not seeking outside, but Guru Sahib is saying that Satguru, Guru Nanak, that is the one that you're going to have to go to get happiness. And you can test other paths. Guru Sahib never stops you from testing other things. Guru Sahib wants you, when you come onto this path, to be very firm within yourself, to have that commitment. And finally, Gur Prasad. We all talk about Gur Prasad, but when you're on this path, a lot of it is grace, which is prasad. Gur Prasad means grace, the Guru's grace. So when you're on this path, a lot of it is your own effort, but a lot of it is also kirpa. Next slide. So what is a Sikh's lifestyle like? Before saying that, I wanted to talk a little bit about what some Gur Sikhs have told me about Sikhi. I knew a very good Gur Sikh. He passed away recently. And he used to say something to all of us. Like, a lot of us used to look up to him. He used to say, Jinna mirtha paonge, unna mirtha ho juga. Which means, however much sweet you put in, that's how much sweet you'll get out. So what he was saying was that if you do something, then you'll get something. Sikhi is a path, right? If you walk on the path, you'll get somewhere. But if you're just standing still and saying, I'm a Sikh, that doesn't mean anything. It's walking, right? So he used to always say, do something. But what is a Sikh's lifestyle like? One analogy that I think is really appropriate is the lotus. The lotus, as you guys probably know, it's on the muddy water. It's in the water, and it's all dirty below it, but it rises above. It's completely separate, but completely apart at the same time. So Guru Sahib says, Jaise jal mein kamal niralam, mur gai na chaane. So he gives you two examples. He said, just like a lotus stays in the water, or a duck flows through water without actually getting wet. Sot shaud paav saagat tariye nanak naam bakhaane. That put your focus into Naam. Put your focus into Naam and you'll cross this world ocean. And jap Naam. It's very simple. Sikhi is about just one thing. Japing Naam. If you jap Naam... yes, we've all seen the YouTube video. But Sikhi, the main thing in Sikhi is just japing Naam. It's so simple, but it's a little bit difficult as well. So if someone does this, Guru Sahib says, you'll cross. And the second thing I wanted to talk about is what Bhai Gurdas. Bhai Gurdas is a really great resource for us as well, because he was a Sikh. And he had his experiences as a Sikh. So his perspective is somewhat closer to ours as well. But he was accepted by Guru Sahib and he was a Brahm Gyani, so he was somewhere. So what he has to say, I think sometimes is really appropriate. And what Bhai Gurdas says is, Marg Khande Tar Hai. That this Khande Tar means the edge of a double-edged sword. And when we shak amrit, it's called Pivot Pohol Khande Tar, right? It's from a khanda. So it's really, I think, interesting that Bhai Gurdas says that this path is like this, like a khanda. Pavjal Par Nala, Valo Nikka Aakhi Hai, Gurpanth Nirala. That it's so delicate, it's so fine, that it's like a hair. And the panth, which means this path, this tharam, is completely different. like I said, it's completely different because in some religions you have like a contract sort of idea. In Christianity, if you get baptized, you say, I accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior. That's essentially your contract, right? That Jesus will then take your sins on and you will go to heaven. In Islam, it's once again a contract that you follow the five pillars of Islam. Like you keep your fast, you do your namaz, you give your zakat, which is your charity, and you will go to paradise. But what makes the Panth Nirala, this Guru Sahib's Panth Nirala, is once again the same thing. You can call yourself a Sikh, but unless you're actually doing something about it, unless you're actually walking the path, don't expect to see a lot happening for you. So it's really a different sort of onus that you have to make the effort. Next slide. So what happens then if you call yourself a spiritual person, or you say, I am a Sikh, but you don't actually follow what you're supposed to do? You don't actually make those efforts. Guru Sahib actually gives a very beautiful shabd about what you can expect then. Gyan, gyan, kath hai sab koi. Everyone talks about gyan. Gyan means knowledge. Kath, kath, baad kare, do koi. That they talk and they argue. People that are in religions, talking about spirituality, they'll argue amongst each other. Different religions will argue. Even in the Sikh dharam, you'll find different scholars arguing, even different jathebandi arguing. Kath kehne te rahe na koi. That no one is beyond talking. Everyone is always talking. Din ras rate mukt na hoi. But without actually being imbued, without being colored in Vaheguru's naam, in Vaheguru's actual nectar, that you won't be free. Gyan te ansab gurte hoi, sachi rahat sacha mansoi. So, Guru Sahib saying, true knowledge comes from the Guru, and sachi rahat sacha mansoi. That person has true rahat, true lifestyle, who follows the Guru, that, and Vaheguru, as a result, resides in that person's mind. Manmukh kathni hai, par rahat na hoi. That a manmukh, he can talk, or she can talk, but they don't have rahat, they don't have that conduct. Naam bhule thau na koi. And if you ignore or you forsake naam, that you'll not find a place anywhere. And that seems harsh. But Guru Sahib is trying to actually save us from making those mistakes. Today you see all kinds of spirituality. Even in our own community, people that I grew up with, like a young person, I'm not going to say his name, but we used to do camps together. He used to be an Amritdhari. And today he's well known. A lot of young Sikhs look up to him. But he says, I don't believe in religion. I don't believe in organized religion. That I believe in bigger principles, but I don't think about God. Or you'll find some people say, oh, I'm an atheist, I believe in spirituality, but organized religion, that's just nonsense. And that, to me, falls right into this trap. That talking about spirituality but not doing anything. Because I've seen those people from close up, and they don't have that lifestyle going for them. They don't have the meditation, they don't have that nimrta. So it's all talk. And anyone can talk a good game. Talking is really cheap. You have all kinds of New Age Gurus, Deepak Chopra, Eckhart Tolle. They're all talking about spirituality and all these things. But without that conduct, Guru Sahib is saying, it's all empty. Next slide. So, there's Pattaniswaye. Pattaniswaye come near the end of Guru Granth Sahib Ji, near the Pogh. And these parts were poets, bards, that actually went and were looking for something in their lives. And they used to sing poetry, but when they met Guru Sahib, they actually had a transformation in themselves. And Bhat Bhikkha is one of those poets. And a shabd that he wrote is in Guru Granth Sahib, and he talks about his own experience. So this is from Guru Granth Sahib. He says, Rahya sant ho tol, saad bho tere jithe. That I was looking for a true saint. He's saying, I was looking for a true saint, and I saw lots of people that are sadhus, that the people consider themselves like, you know, sadhus. I saw lots of those people. And he describes them, sannyasi, those people that leave the world, tapasi hain, which are meditators, they say I'm meditating. Mukhoi Pandita Mithe. And he says these pandits, these religious scholars, they talk a good game. They're oh mithe ne mo. They talk sweet words. Bas ek ho fireo. That for 1 year, imagine this is a real person talking about his experience. Bas ek ho fireo. That for 1 year I wandered around. Kine no pacho laya. That no one satisfied me. Imagine this for ourselves. He must have been truly a seeker if he spent a year of his whole life just wandering, trying to find someone who could satisfy him spiritually. Kehte ya kehti suni rehat ko khushi na aaya. That there were so many that talked, but I didn't find anyone whose rehat, whose conduct satisfied me. So it all came down to rehat, right? Conduct. Har naam chhod dooja lage, tin ke gun ho kya kaho. That those that leave naam, that anyone that is talking about spirituality but they're not talking about naam, that what qualities of theirs can I talk about? They don't have any qualities, he's saying. That spirituality without naam is empty. It's just words. Gur dei milayo pikhya jiv tu rakhe tev raho. That he's saying, Vaheguru led me to the Guru. And now he's saying to Guru Amar Das, that however you keep me, however you want me to be, that's how I will be. So it came down to that. And now he's saying, whatever Guru Sahib you want me to be, because that's fulfilled him spiritually, I will do just that. Next slide. So what is that? I've been saying it over and over. It's a code of conduct. It's having that action in your life. It's living the words. It's not just empty talk. It's actually living that experience of Sikhi. And there's another associated word, it's called maryada. Maryada means protocol. And there's different protocols for different things, like in Guru Sahib's Darbar, there's a maryada for that. For preparing deg, prashad, there's a maryada for that. So they're both linked, but what I'm going to be talking more about is personal rehat, your inner and your outer code of your conduct. So rehat is essentially an infrastructure. Spirituality is a lot like water. It rises, it falls. There's very few people that have only up. Chardikala, we all hear about Chardikala, right? Chardikala means constantly rising spirits. And then there's a step below that, which is Kardikala, which means slow sloping off. And then you have Tendikala, which is downwards. Unfortunately, most of us, including myself, we go through all three of those phases. And what Rehat does, it's like a dam. Water goes up and it might fall down. But if you have a structure, if you have like a dam, it won't go below a certain level. It'll keep you at a certain level and help you, even if you fall, to go up again very quickly. So it's just essentially checks and balances in your life. So it's not that, oh, today I'm hot on spirituality, today I'll do something, and tomorrow I'm not feeling as good about it, I'm feeling lazy, I won't do anything. Rehat is just that basic structure that you want to work from. A good example is a jungle versus a garden. Both contain plants, both contain wildlife, both, you know, they have beautiful things in them. But people are afraid of a jungle. Why? Because it doesn't have any order to it. A jungle can be a little bit scary. Most people in India, they didn't want to go into a jungle because, you know, they could get hurt. But a garden, very same, it's nature, but it has an order to it. And in the same way, Guru Sahib says that rehat will make what is like a jungle without order into a garden. Something beautiful, something people actually want to go to. So what are the basics of rehat? I've talked a lot about it in an abstract way. I want to talk about it in a concrete way. What are the foundations of rehat? You start off with the four kurats. Can anyone volunteer one of the four kurats? Anyone? Japnam Singh? One of the four kurats?
Cutting hair.
Cutting your hair. So that's one. These four things, Guru Sahib has taught us that they will ruin your spiritual jivan. And if you're Amritari, if you do any of these four, you actually have to shuck Amrit again. Your spiritual journey has to start afresh. So the first is cutting your hair. Even from the times of Guru Nanak Dev Ji, there are records that Guru Nanak Dev Ji used to tell his Sikhs that don't cut your hair. There's a reason for that, obviously. I'm not going to go too deeply into it, but one is identity, second is hair God has given you, it's sticking to your natural form. at any rate, Guru Sahib says to do this and not to cut your hair, and that for me is personally enough, but if anyone wants to discuss it further, I'm more than happy to. Another Qur'at, there's one down, three to left. Harman Singh.
Sharab.
Sharab, intoxicants. So, Guru Sahib says that avoid intoxicants, tobacco, sharab, all these things, avoid them. The next is mas, which means meat. It doesn't mean, like, for example, I mean, a lot of people go, you're vegetarians, but when you're eating thing, you're eating bacteria, when you're breathing, it's a totally different story. Meat is kutta. Kutta is not halal meat. Kutta means a slaughtered animal. So we can't live without taking life. It's just the way life works. But kutta means an animal that you've slaughtered, or someone else has slaughtered. And that means that you actually had to lose daya, mercy inside yourself, to do that act, to satisfy your own tongue. And Guru Sahib has told us that daya, mercy, compassion, is the father of dharm, is the parent of dharm. And dharm means religion, faith, spirituality. So if you do that, you've actually made a big mistake. And finally, it's three, one down.
Extramarital
relations. That doesn't mean simply having an affair once you're married. That means even before you're married, not having any sort of sexual relations or inappropriate relations with the opposite gender or the same gender. All right. Then you have the five kakas. The five kakas, obviously, there's going to be some dispute over this one. I think it's kaiski. Some people think it's kaisk, but it doesn't really matter because both are mandatory, and I think you'll find everyone who agrees that both are necessary. The kaisk and the kaiski are essentially a sign of your spirituality. Santhi Singh yesterday talked about that being one in honor from Vaheguru, and it's also part of your identity. Your kanga, which is your wooden comb, kada, which is obviously your iron kada, your kashara and your karpan. So having these at all times, that's the second part of that. And then the next part is the seven barni nitnim. So like you did your nitnim today, that's something that you have to do every day. And that's, like I said, it all comes down to putting words and putting thoughts and concepts into action. And if you follow this, it's actually giving a practical form to Sikhi in your life. Otherwise, it's just emptiness. It's just empty talk. So the seven Barni Nitim, Javji Sahab, Jav Sahab, Swayye, Jaupi Sahab, Anand Sahab, and then at night, Rara Sahab, before going to sleep, Sola Sahab. Necessary as a minimum for everybody that wants to be seriously following Sikhi. Next slide. The next thing I wanted to talk about. Guru Ram Das has given us a shabd, which he makes another concept very clear to us. He says, Gur Satgur ka jo sikhya khai so palke uthar naam te aave. That someone who calls themselves a Sikh, that what they have to do, not an option, they have to get up early and meditate on Naam. Udham kare palke parvati ishnan kare amritsar naam. That udham means effort. That this person must make the effort to get up, do ishnan before dawn, and then amritsar naam means do ishnan but also meditate on Naam, do gurbani da jap at the same time. Upadesh guru har har jap jap sab kel ve paap dokh na jave fir chade divs gurbani gaave pende utte har naam te aave. So Guru Sahib is saying that he japs Naam, and then when the day rises, he continues to read Bani, whatever he's doing, or she's doing. Jo saas graste aaye mera har har so gur sikh guru man paave, jisno dyal hove mera swami, tis gur sikh guru upadesh sunave. That whoever recites on Naam with every breath, that sikh is pleasing to the guru, that person has the kirpa of the guru. And then Guru Sahib says that only that person can become a Sikh and can hear the Guru's teachings, who has very good karma, who has very good fortunes. That only that person who Guru Sahib has become merciful to. And what does Guru Sahib says? Jan nanak tood mangay tis gur sikh ki jo aap japai avara naam japa. That Guru Sahib is saying, I myself am the dust of that person's feet that follows this. Guru Sahib is not saying it's easy necessarily. He's saying that if someone's doing this, I am the dust of their feet even, who inspires other people to japa Naam. I had a question. I do this column for the Ottawa Citizen every week. And the question I had last week was, is your religion like a converting religion? Do you have a duty to bring others to faith? And in the Sikh faith, what's unique is not that we go out and we knock on doors saying, hey, do you want to become a Sikh? Here's some pamphlets. It doesn't work that way. What our main mode of prachar is living that lifestyle ourselves. And through living that lifestyle ourselves, we can become an inspiration to others. So that's what it means. If you are living that lifestyle, you are yourself becoming a pracharak. But just empty words doesn't mean much in Sikhi. Next slide. So it all comes down to Amrit Vela, Guru Sahib talked about in the last slide. And there's two toks that I think are really important. Sabahi Salah Jinitaya Ekuman, that Guru Sahib is saying that early in the morning, that those that meditate with one mind on Naam, say pure shah. The Guru Sahib gives you the example of a battle. Those of us who wake up or try and wake up, you know it's not easy. Sometimes you're tired, sometimes you just don't feel like getting up. But Guru Sahib gives you the example of a battle. That at that moment when you're supposed to wake up, Guru Sahib is saying, make it like a battle. That feel like you can die, but you're not going to give this up. It's a high ideal. I'm not saying I can even follow it all the time. But this is what Guru Sahib is saying, that it's like a battle. And Guru Sahib is recognizing that it's not easy. And Pai Gurdas, like I said, he's a Sikh, so his opinion also counts. He says, Vaktai upar lad mare, amrit vele shabd lape. That at that time, it's like a battle. You can die, but you have to get up. That it's a do or die situation. And at amrit vele shabd lape. That he will sing the shabd at amrit vele. This is a foundation of Sikhi. If someone says, I'm a Sikh, Guru Sahib is saying, then you have to get up at Amrit Vela. Next slide. Some thoughts on Amrit Vela. I wanted to make this discussion about every day, how we can incorporate Sikhi in. And I recognize Amrit Vela is not easy. Sometimes it's not getting up so much as it is going to sleep. If you're going to sleep at 1 or 2, and you think you can get up at Amrit Vela half an hour later or an hour later, you're just deluding yourself. Some people have odd sleeping patterns. Like, I have a relative who's an artist, and she actually wakes through the night, and when the dawn, like around 10 maybe at the latest in the morning, she'll go to sleep. And I know young people that have weird sleeping patterns, and some people even, they might wake through the entire night and they go, well, I want to keep my Amrit Vela, so I'm just going to stay awake and then I'm going to do my Amrit Vela and then go to sleep after. And that really doesn't make sense. It's not practical, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in the next slide. Sikhi is all about being practical, it's also about having uddam. There's no shortcuts. You have to have that effort, because nothing is free. So the other thing I wanted to talk about is Gurmat Ishnan. Waking up and doing Ishnan. Washing your kis, that's important, it's good. You should wash your kis if you can. It's a part of that. Because hair, your kes, is actually considered by Guru Sahib to be your Shiromani Ang, your topmost Ang. It's considered very important. So that also helps you become more alert. Another good idea is to actually do Ishnan with cold water if you can. It can help you become more alert. It's good for your health. It's hard. I mean, if there's one net that I wish I didn't have to follow sometimes, it's like on a cold day having to do Pandai Ishnan. It really takes some effort from you. But it's really good for you. What happens if you don't get up? Yeah.
So you mean there's benefits of cold water. What is the benefits? What are those benefits?
Those benefits are health related as well as attention related. When you bathe in cold water, it's been proven that it increases your circulation. It makes you more alert as well, just mentally. If you take a nice warm Ishnan, it's steam all over. It might even put you to sleep. I mean, some people suggest, you know, warm baths to put you to sleep. So cold water actually has a good effect in terms of waking you up. And if you're waking up at Amrit Vela, the last thing you want to do is wake up and then go back to sleep. So Thanda Ishnan actually helps you do that. What happens if you don't get up? A Gursikh once made an analogy to a roll call. Like in an army, you have a roll call. Like every day they read off the list. Guru Sahib, every day you can consider it's like a roll call for all Gursikhs. And if you skip enough Amrit Vela, you should be afraid that your name might get cut from Guru Sahib's list. And I've seen it myself. If you compromise enough in terms of your diet, eventually you keep falling. But if you just one day, when it seems hard, you get up, you'll get more kirpa even. It becomes easier. So it's not something to be taken lightly to miss your amitvara. And some people say, well, as I get older, maybe I'll start doing it then. I'm a student right now, it's hard. And I'll tell you, it doesn't get any easier when you're older. Your body gets more tired, and you might have kids, and the kids might go to sleep late. Life continues to get more complicated. So there's no excuses that I'll do it later. Do it now. Next slide. Nitname. The question was about tanda pani as well, and there's a ratnama that actually talks about it. It's the Pai Nandlal ratnama. Pai Santhbir Singh talked about it yesterday. It's Pai Nandlal asking Guru Gobind Singh Ji questions about that, that any normal Sikh, any regular Sikh like us might ask. And Guru Gobind Singh says to Pai Nandlal, thande pani jo nah naave, bin jap pade prasad jo khaave. That person that doesn't bathe in cold water or starts eating without doing jap or his nitname or her nitname, bin ra sama jo khove, that person that loses their, wastes their time without doing the ras, kirtan pade bin jo sove, and that person that goes to sleep without doing sola sab, kirtan sola, that person is making a mistake, that's a violation of rat, that's against what Guru Sahib wants you to have in your life. So as I mentioned before, seven barnis is the minimum that you want to be doing. Seven barnis is like a baseline, and the more you do, the better it is for you. And frankly, the more barni you do, the more you'll be inspired to do. Because like I said, Sikhi is a path and it's an experience. If you're reading barni, it's not going to be easy to start with, but when you start getting the taste of it, when you start actually experiencing what it's meant to give you, you'll want to do more and more. It's not like you have to force yourself on the Sikhi path. To start off, it's like a boulder, really. Once you push it, it starts hard, but once it gets rolling, it'll roll faster and faster. Same way the way you read Barney or follow other dads. Sukhmani Sahib, great Barney to be reading. There's a lot of Barneys to read, but Sukhmani Sahib is a Barney that a lot of Guru Sikhs feel you should read if you're serious about spirituality. It's 24 Ashtapadiyan. Guru Arjan Dev Ji composed this Barney. And if you haven't read it, it's really good. It has a lot of daily lessons for you and a lot of questions that you might have as a person on the spiritual path. It is answered in Sukhmani Sahib. Next. So Sikhi in an everyday life, when you're at work, school, or home. I mentioned this before and I want to be very clear. Sikhi doesn't promote laziness. It doesn't promote, because other religions, at that time, even now, some people that said, oh, I'm spiritual, they left their homes. Very lazy people. Pandits, they were very lazy people. They had people bring them food. They used to say some prayers and everything else was done for them. Sikhi isn't like that. Guru Sahib wants you to live a very productive and like a good life that's not separate from the world, that actually helps the world. So, being productive. Guru Sahib actually says, Vanj mere aal sahar paas binanti. Aalas means laziness. Guru Sahib is actually saying, get rid of my laziness, Guru Sahib. Vaheguru, help me become a productive person. Sikhi isn't an excuse to do poorly or underachieve. Sometimes, I've seen this among some young people, that they might say, oh, I found Sikhi, I'm into Sikhi now, I'm into Naam. School doesn't matter, nothing matters, it's all Maya, and I'm just going to jump Naam. And frankly, a lot of the times, they don't even do that properly. Sikhi isn't an excuse to do poorly in life. And if you do well in life, you'll inspire others as well. For example, my parents, the biggest fear they had, my own parents were Monne for a long time. My dad kept his hair somewhat recently. The biggest fear they had was that, okay, you have now started doing Sikhi and you're getting up early in the morning, it's unnatural. My dad used to say that the birds aren't even up, this is not according to nature. And how are you going to go to school? What are you going to do? I said, don't worry about it. And at first, I'll be very honest with you, in my undergrad years, I had some crazy things going on for myself. And I'm telling you this, not because I want you to do it, but not to do it. For example, in one of my years, I think third year of my undergrad, I decided, I'm going to finish a Sahaj Paath before going to the first day of school. And I'd done half already, and I figured, you know, it should be done. And school came around, I wasn't done. And I was like, no, no, I've made a conviction. I'll finish this edge part. And I ended up going 2 weeks without actually doing the part or going to school, just sort of sitting around at home. And then I realized I'm missing a lot of class and actually got down to it. But that's not what Sikhi teaches, to mess around with your school life or your home life. Be practical. Well-balanced and organized life, same thing. Clothing. How you dress definitely affects you. I prefer to dress in Varna. It helps me. It reminds me that I'm different, that I have a different goal in life, that I have a different sort of vichartara, a different ideology that I'm trying to follow. And if I ever forget that, other people will remind me, or if I look in a mirror, that'll remind me. But clothing makes a difference. And one bhakti that I wanted to do is, I would encourage you to start, at least when you go to Gurdwara, wear Varna. Like, if you have it. If you don't have it, I mean, that's a different story. But when you go in Guru Sahib's Hajuri, remember I talked about earlier Maryada versus Rait, how they're linked but a little bit different? Maryada for Guru Sahib's Darbar is to wear Varna if you can. And that makes that experience more special. It's not just you show up in the shorts that you were wearing when you were playing some sport or something. You actually internally are making it a different experience. It's a special experience. So I would encourage you to actually have that experience of wearing Varna. It makes a difference, and it made a big difference for me anyways. Socializing at school and work. Finding the right types of friends. Sometimes your friends can sink you or they can save you, right? And Sikhi is a lot like athletics, actually, in the sense that athletes design their entire life for that sport. What they eat, what they wear, what company they keep, what schedule they have, it's all about making themselves a better athlete. And in Sikhi, the idea is the same, to make your lifestyle most conducive to jumping nam, most conducive to reaching your goal. So find those sorts of friends that will actually help you along the goal, along that path. Honest money. Sikhi teaches you to do kirt, to earn an honest living. And if you don't have an honest living, that paisa, that money, is considered haram. In Islam, haram is a very big concept. In Sikhi, it also exists, but it means not good. And Guru Sahib says very clearly, partan, other people's, that illegitimate money, partan, someone else's body that you shouldn't be coveting, parti ninda, doing ninda or slander of someone else, akad kai harkaya, that this will make you crazy, that this is something that if you take part in these things, you lose your mind and you lose your path. So it's very important to avoid all those three things. What does that mean in a practical sense? Yeah.
Sorry, I was just going to ask you about that in the practical term, but I'll let you finish.
In practical terms, what it means is, like, there's all kinds of frauds that we see in the Punjabi community today that some of our relatives might be doing, or even in the mainstream community. You see people on welfare when they don't need to be. You see people making disability claims. I'm a lawyer, I mean, I see this all the time. People making disability claims even though there's nothing wrong with them, just so that they think they can live easier. That's not honest money. Honest money is something that you've earned legitimately, not a handout or something fraudulent, some sort of fraud, like gambling or something. I mean, and whatever money you do earn, the swand is mandatory. The swand means 1/10. That's actually helping out other people around you. And that's a rat as well. And from Pai Dandal again, Guru Gobind Singh Ji said, the swand guru na devi chur bol jo khai. That person that doesn't give 1/10 of their income and lies to earn their income, kahe Gobind Singh Lal, kiska kashna bisar. That I don't trust that person, Guru Sahib says. That person that lies to earn their livelihood, or they don't give their diswan, that I don't trust that person. And losing Guru Gobind Singh Ji's trust is obviously a big thing. Next slide. I wanted to talk a little bit about Sangat again.
Okay.
Yep.
Just one question, you know, in regards to honest money, right? Let's say if you have a business, right? I just want to know what your thoughts are. This, you're a home builder, right? Your cost is $100 per square foot. You're selling it at $200. Now, is that honest, or like, how is that? Because you're still making a profit, right? If you're a businessman, What's your thoughts on that?
I think when you have these sort of questions, the best person to ask is yourself. Your inner voice will tell you if what you're doing is right. Yeah. Earning a profit on a business isn't wrong. Obviously, ripping people off, that's not a good thing. But your insides will tell you. Your insides will tell you if I'm doing the right thing, if you feel good about yourself. I'll give you another example from my own life. When in my student days, you know who Direct Energy is?
Yes.
I used to be a door-to-door guy for Direct Energy. And it's a horrible, horrible job, because you have to knock on people's doors, and they're going to yell at you for disturbing them and whatnot. And one day, I was selling electricity at 21.9 cents. I remember this. And the next day, they gave me a contract, and it went up to 30 cents. And I said, so did the cost increase for some reason? They're like, no. It's just, we need to make money for the company. And I couldn't live with myself. And I was like, I'm ripping people off. I can't do this. And my inside told me it wasn't right. So I stopped selling those contracts. And I got in a little bit of trouble at work, didn't make as much money, but at least I was satisfied with myself that what I'm doing is the right thing, right? Small, insignificant sort of example, but one is just to say that you'll know if you're doing the right thing or not.
The reason why I was asking is because you know the cost is 100, and if you're selling at 200, is that deceit?
No, if you're making a profit, but like I said, I don't know the specifics, so it's hard for me to say. And the other thing is, satsangat mein lahiya madho jaise matak makhira. If you find good sangat that inspires you to jap nam, Guru Sahib gives you the example of the bee. Just like the bee goes out, does its work, and then comes back into its hive, do the same thing, have the same approach. And your sangat isn't just people, it can be your books, videos, internet, television, it's all sangat. Facebook, chatting. It's all your sangha, yeah?
Sir, I don't understand the analogy of the bee.
A bee will go from the hive, and all day it'll collect honey and nectar, and then it'll come back again to the hive. It's like its home base. Make sangha your home base. That you'll do your work in the day, you'll do whatever you need to do, but sangha is where your home is. That's where your inspiration comes from. But like I said, all these things are sangha, Facebook, chatting. From my personal experience, I think they do more harm than good, and you have to be very careful about them. But that's something you all have to decide. I mean, I know that they're just a part of life now, and in school you need them and whatnot, but just be very careful. Next slide. You are what you eat. Eating is a part of Gurmat as well. Eating the right sorts of things. Guru Sahib says, Guru Nanak Dev Ji actually says, Baba, hor khana khushi fuat. Eating anything else is just for your own sense of happiness, but it'll lead you to kuari. Kuari means being misled, led astray. Jit khate tan peediye man mein chalai vikar. That avoid this, that upon eating which, your body is hurt or your mind will get vikar. Vikar means vices. So, what does that mean in a practical sense? Meat, like I said, is one of those things that Gursikhs avoid. But you have to sort of figure out for yourself. If you eat a heavy meal before going to sleep and that makes you miss Amrit Vela, then that's not a good thing, right? But you have to know what is appropriate for your life. Controlling what you eat, like I said, same sort of idea. Going and eating at restaurants. This is my own personal opinion, and I'm trying to base this on Red, but I don't think you can have purity of eating if you're eating at restaurants. It seems difficult to me, because as you know, eating pure food that's not, you know, jutta or anything like that, it's a part of Gursikhi. It's not something a lot of us like to talk about maybe, but it is a part of Gursikhi. What made me think about it was actually at a retreat like this. There was a retreat, and it was held at a retreat center, and the cooks were actually the retreat staff. And as I was walking in, the cook was actually greeting everyone as they were coming and shaking their hand. And as I was walking by him, ready to have my dinner, he shook my hand, and when I looked at his top pocket, it was it had a cigarette pack in it. And this was the first time I thought about it. I was like, I never know who's cooking my food, but now I'm meeting the guy, and he's got cigarettes in his top pocket. It's not as though when he was cooking this, the cigarettes were sitting apart. It's not as though he's not a smoker, that in between cooking my meal, he was out having a smoke break. And is that something I feel comfortable eating? And that was the first time I decided, no, I don't feel comfortable eating this. Other times, if you go to restaurants, Western-style cooking, actually, you taste the food. And according to Gursikhi, you try and keep your food as pure as possible. So I personally think it's a bad idea, but I mean, I'm not going to tell you what to do. You have to figure it out for yourselves. What sort of food a Gursikh strives to eat is food cooked with naam. That means when the food is being cooked, you should be japing naam or reciting Gurbani, and that gives that food a certain vibration, a positive vibe that helps you in your jeevan. Paidanti Singh was a great Gursikh. I'm going to talk a little bit about his life later on, but he used to say that anyone that eats deg that's properly prepared, prashad, that's prepared by a Gursikh who was japing naam and reciting Gurbani, that will boost that person's jeevan even just intrinsically. That'll give you a spiritual boost. Another good thing to help is sarblo. You see the bate, for example, in the divan when deg is served, or you might see them around otherwise. Sarblo is a pratan rat. It's an old rat that a lot of Gursikhs keep. It started at the time of Guru Gobind Singh Ji when the amrit was prepared, because amrit is prepared in sarblo. It has a good effect. If anyone wants to ask me more about it, I'm more than happy to talk about it. But it's also something that's good for your... I personally have found it very helpful. Next slide.
Professor?
Yeah?
Can you define jute?
Defining jute in English is very, very difficult.
And we actually have a question and answer session afterwards, so if you want to keep the questions for later, we can... I think it's probably better.
Okay, maybe I'll do it that. I'll do it later then. But defining jute is very difficult because there's no English equivalent for that word. Love and marriage, something a lot of young people are concerned about. I'm going to try and talk about this as briefly as possible. Be careful. Be careful. I've seen a lot of Gursikhs with the best of intentions fall into the trap of having relationships that have hurt them in the long run. And if you make this mistake, you will pay for it. I've seen it many, many times. Keep it within bounds. It's impossible. We're not extremists that we say don't talk to the opposite gender, because that's just impractical. You have to deal with people of the opposite gender, but make sure you do it from a place that's pure, from a place that's stable, not with bad intentions. It's not as though, I mean, tanji pranji pranji, but inside I'm going, wow, she'd be really great for a wife. That's bad. It's really bad. It'll hurt your spirituality. In fact, Guru Sahib has said that that person in Sangat who looks at the person of opposite gender with bad intentions, which is, good spouse, that person is a tankaya. That person is making a misconduct. Infatuation versus love, and even this concept of love, often it's infatuation, not real. You have created something that you adore, but that person may or may not be that real thing. It's like an imaginary sort of partner that you've created in your own mind. You've fallen in love with yourself. And imagine if that love that you feel was directed towards Vaheguru. All these love songs, I had a friend once, and he used to say, I don't mind listening to these love songs. And I said, why? They're horrible. Because I was complaining to him, I used to work at a factory as well, that they used to play these, you know, the Cher's songs and all these, all day, and it used to, like, hurt my ears. And he said, I like listening to them. I said, why? He said, imagine if they were singing that about Vaheguru, that, oh, I can't live without you, this, that, and the other thing. Imagine if that experience was directed towards Vaheguru. There's a story actually about a pug that every day he had to go meet his wife. Every day. He had to. And even when she was away on a trip, she said, will you be okay? He said, no, I think I'll be okay. But in the middle of the night, he couldn't stop himself. He actually got up and went to her house, and she was embarrassed, like, why can't you stay even one night without me? What's wrong with you? And she said to him this very thing. She said, if you loved God the way you think you love me, imagine where you'd be today. Imagine where you'd be. And that changed everything for him. And he actually started thinking about bhakti and all that. And it's true. If we loved God the way we love our so-called romantic partner, it would make a big difference in our lives. Keeping your chola spotless. A lot of Gursikhs talk about you coming into this world with a chitta chola when you start Gursikhi. Don't put any stains on it. Don't do anything that you would regret in the future. Gurmukh approach to marriage. I don't think dating and all that is a good approach. I mean, it just leads itself into things that you don't want to go into. But enough said about this. I'm more than happy to talk about these issues later on. Next slide. So if you follow that, I've been talking about these little rats and putting Sikhi into a practical form. If you follow these rats, what should be happening in your life. And this is from Sukhmani Sahib. I mentioned Sukhmani Sahib earlier. Guru Sahib says, Satgur Sikhi Kare Pritapal, that the Guru keeps his Gur Sikh, protects, Sevak Ko Gur Sada Dayal, that the Guru is always merciful to his Sevak, his servant. Sikh Ki Gur Dormat Mal Hire, those bad thoughts, Guru Sahib gets rid of those. Gur Bachani Har Naam Uchre, and through the grace of the Guru, he recites Naam or she recites Naam. Satgur Sikhi Bandhan Karta, that Sikh's shackles are all broken. Gur ka Sikh Bikar Te Hatta, Bikar's like Kaam Krodh Lo Mohankar, that Guru Sahib saves the Sikh from that as well. Satgur Sikh Ko Naam Tande, that Guru Sahib is giving the Sikh the true wealth of Naam. Gur ka Sikh Vad Paagi Hai, that Gur Sikh is very fortunate. Satgur Sikh Ka Halat Palt Sawara, that the Gur Sikh, that Gur Sikh's here and the hereafter are both looked after. Nanak Satgur Sikh Ko Jinal Samara, that the Guru will protect the Sikh like keeping him to his own chest. Like a child is kept to the mother's chest, the Guru Sahib will keep you like a child, keeping you close to the chest. One thing that I get is, I'm a Amritdhari, how come that doesn't happen to me? How come I feel like crap all the time? Why do I feel depression? Why do I feel like I don't want to get up? Why do I feel like none of this matters sometimes? And it really comes back to that. Comes back to that daily living, daily conduct. I had a friend actually, he inspired me to come into Gur Sikhi in a lot of ways. But somewhere along the lines, he kind of got off track. And he came to me once and he said, I just went to a Buddhist retreat. It was a week-long retreat and I feel so good. I feel like I've learned something in my life that those Rehan Sabhais, that Japing Noms never happened with them. And I said, well, what did you do at this retreat? He said, for 7 days, I wasn't allowed to say a word. For 7 days, I had to just concentrate on my breathing. And I wasn't allowed to wear my kakads, I couldn't do my nitname. But for those 7 days, I just focused on what was inside, and now I feel like, I never felt like this before. And I thought to myself, if you spent 7 days actually focusing on Naam without saying a word, do you not think that you would have had even greater an experience? We don't put in that effort. We say it's not working, but sometimes we forget when we're in school, even if you want to get a high school degree, that works out to what? 13 years at least of school? 13 years of 6 to 8 hours a day, not including homework? Anything that's worthwhile takes time and takes effort, but we're not willing to put that same effort sometimes into Sikhi, into finding Vaiguru. So don't say that, oh, it's not working out for me, unless you're actually putting in that effort and following that conduct. And how does Guru Sahib finish it? He says, this Gur Sikh ko hon sada namaskari, ya Gur ke paane Gur Sikh chale. Guru Sahib says, I am always bowing to that Gur Sikh that has followed the path of Gur Sikhi, because it's such a big thing. But actually following it, actually following that path. Next slide. So, I don't want to lose the forest for the trees. And that's sometimes what happens. Sikhi's not just about these little rats. It's the big goal. And what is that big goal? Gurmati to Gurmat to Gur Sikhi. Kat janana. In your own body, you should have light. Naam ansakai. That Naam will be your savior at the end. This is all about seeing Vaiguru inside. About having that jyot inside you. About having that experience of Vaiguru within you. And if you're not looking for that, then you've gone off the path again. All these rats are only relevant if it's about experiencing Vaiguru within yourself. Did I get the book? The book. Next slide. At my life, this is a personal experience. I was at a stage where I didn't really understand what Sikhi was about anymore. It seemed like an abstract concept. Press it again. And I was sitting at a Gurdwara library, waiting for my father actually. And I just was passing time, and there was a book. And I didn't even know which book, I was just wanting to pass some time. And I pulled it out of the shelf and I started reading. And it was actually this book, it was an older copy of it. It's called The Autobiography of Paisabhan Thir Singh. And I read this book, I started reading it in the library, and I actually didn't stop reading it until I was done the following day. I actually took it home, I read through the night, didn't go to sleep. Because for me, it actually put into practical terms what Sikhi is all about. And I'm going to just read an excerpt for you about Bhai Sahib Singh. Bhai Sahib Singh was around in the early part of the 1900s. He passed away in 1961. And he was someone that followed Rath very closely, but in his earlier life, he wanted to experience Vaheguru. He wanted to have that experience of God. And he structured his whole life for it. In fact, he was doing non-stop Sukhmani Sahibs. And then he says that one day I decided, today I'm going to see Vaheguru. That I'm not going to stop tonight until I see God. And then he said, I was jumping Naam all night. And then he realized, I'm not worthy of this. That I don't deserve this. And he said, I felt a little bit despondent. And that he was sitting up straight and that he lay down. He was in his room. He says, I lay down, but he kept jumping Naam. And what happened then was Kirpa. Because I've talked about Uddam, effort. But in the end, it's also about Kirpa. And what Bhai Sahib says, I'm just going to read some excerpts from this, because I think this changed my life, and I would encourage you to, I mean, afterwards you can get a copy, I think, from Japanam anyways. But here's an excerpt that changed my life anyways, that put it all into perspective. Bhai Sahib writes, my hope of having a vision of God began to recede. I didn't feel quite worthy of it. This made me despondent and sad, but even in this passionate state, the continuous repetition of the divine name went on. And then he goes on, only a short period elapsed in this pessimistic mood. Suddenly and unexpectedly, there was an illumination of dazzling light within my whole being. I could now experience that splendorous cooling light face to face, and yet I couldn't endure its dazzling splendor. I cried out like a person overwhelmed by an overpowering experience. I became light as a flower. A strange and unbearable sweet blazing light began to shimmer with all its splendor within me and outside me. The next moment, I saw the light pervading the whole atmosphere. My eyes are closed, my hands are clasped. By the force of some unseen power, I was lifted up till I touched the roof. I prayed to God, Lord, help me to endure this unbearable experience. Within a twinkling of an eye, I was laying on the floor. I touched the floor as lightly as a balloon and did not feel hurt. I had just been lifted up as a man goes up in a swing and then came down in a backswing. So he goes on. I'm not going to read too much. He's actually written quite a bit more. I'm just giving you some excerpts. Blessed was my search on this night. I could see a sea of divine light flooding within me and outside me in shimmering resplendence. I was able to endure this unendurable light only by praying utterances from Gurbani, which strengthened my mind and soul by seeking grace and strength. The more I was absorbed in it, the more wonderful and sublimely dazzling spiritual phenomena were seen with my inner eyes. And then he says, I could now see the roof and the walls of the room in which I was sitting, through the roof. Right to the sky, I could see beyond space and crystal clear and bathed in purity. The whole of the universe was filled with incomprehensible light. And then he doesn't know if he's actually having a dream or if this is real. So the person he was living with wakes him up, says, it's 2 a.m., wake up, Ramatvirla. And he says to him, am I dreaming or am I really talking to you? And he says, what are you talking about? Of course you're waking. And he went in, had his Ishnan Bhai Sahib at Amritvela, and he was reading, he started doing Japji Sahib. And he says this, I was so deeply absorbed in the blissful mood that the recitation of Japji became a continuous deep meditation. Every line of Japji revealed such a spiritual joy of divine knowledge and inner light as I had never heard or experienced before. I tried my utmost to complete the recitation at the usual speed, but at every line my mind stopped and was lost in reflection over its intuitive revealed meaning. It's difficult to describe this blissful mental condition. I have no words to express it. There's a lot more to his experience that I've sort of glossed over and just don't have the time to go over. But Bhai Sahib's life for me is an inspiration. He followed Gurmat as far as he could. He kept Sarbu awake, and even he was imprisoned by the British, and even in jail, he didn't give up on his death. But even this, when he's reciting Japji Sahib, we just go through it just like this. He's saying that every line was revealing a new meaning within myself. That this cooling light, I'm face to face with it, and every line was a new experience. And that's the way Gurbani is. It's like we read the translations from Sikhi to the Mass, and that's good to some extent. But Gurbani is an experience, and as you move on spiritually, it has a different experience. It has a different meaning for you. But that's what Sikhi is all about, experiencing Vaiguru. Next slide. This is my last slide. Now what? We've come to Khalsa camp, we have a few days left. What do? Do we wait till next year? Do we wait for another camp? Next. What Sikhi is all about is taking a step. Make a small step in your life. It could be getting up at Amrit Vela or reading your Nitname every day, or if you're not doing any part, doing Japji Sahib. But take a step. Walk on the path, just walk one step. And what happens if you walk one step? Next. Bhai Gurdas, who I've been saying has that experience as a Sikh like us, he says, Jan Shan Gur Ek Panda Jai Jal. If you walk on the Guru's path just one step, Satguru Kot Panda Aage Hoi Leth, that Satguru will come hundreds and thousands of steps to come get you. But you have to take that one step. So I would encourage you, don't worry about anything I'm saying now. One step. If you're not wearing your kagaz, say, hey, I'm going to stop cutting my case, or I'm going to start wearing a dastar, or I'm going to start at least doing my mool mantra in the mornings. Take one step, and Guru Sahib, by Gurdas' experience, will come 100,000 steps. And in my own life, I'll tell you this. I've always done ardas to Guru Sahib, that Guru Sahib, I've made my efforts. Like when I shucked Amrit, I had no idea. I didn't even know what Amrit Vela was. Like my Masi, it was in India, she said, Amrit Vela, we're taking a swede. I was like, why would I get up in the morning? Why? And she said, oh, did it sick on day or today on day? I was like, sure, I didn't know. But in my experience, in my whole life, it's almost as though Guru Sahib has pulled me along. When I didn't know where to go, he pulled me forward. And it's been the same with every Guru Sikh I've spoken to. It's an experience. And you have to have trust Guru Sahib will take you forward. So that's all I had to say for today. Like I said, I'm sorry if I offended anyone. And these are just my thoughts. If anyone wants to question me or maybe correct me, I'm more than happy to hear you out. But that's all for now. Vaheguru Ji Ka Khalsa.
Bole Sonihal.
The Japnam Singh says, question and answers. Any questions I can try and answer?
Jute Bari.
Like I said, jute is not a concept that you have in the Western world. The best you can come to is some sort of an understanding of purity. But anything that's not cooked with Naam, anything that's not cooked with Gurbani, in my understanding, that's not pure. So everything is Juta unless it has that vibration of Naam in it. Everything is intrinsically, nothing can be clean. You can rub anything you want, but true purity will come when that has the vibration of Naam. It's been cooked or prepared with love and with Gurbani. So that's my understanding of jute. I could be wrong.
So when you're preparing food at home, should you, what part should you be doing? Should you be doing mool mantra, or what part should you be doing?
Whichever part you want. You can do mool mantra, you can do Japji Sahib, any part you wish, but it shouldn't be, like sometimes, I mean, you're cooking food, your kids are like, oh, that's not the proper thing to be doing, right? That's not an appropriate way of preparing food. It should be done with love, it should be done with Gurbani, and that will have an effect on you spiritually as well. And it's not just Sikhs that believe this, there's a lot of other groups that have the same experience, that will say the same thing, that food has to be prepared in a correct way, in a proper way. Any other questions?
A question see in the question box about gas, why put in the bag?
There was a question in the Q&A box. Why do we put gas from our Ganga into a bag, and why do we not?
And what's it done? Because I didn't realize what you do with the gas once in the bag.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the answer.
Gays, like I said, are considered very special, considered very precious. the Gursikhs, especially so when you shuck Amrit, when they put Amrit in your hair. So just like when you have a dead body, you don't just throw it away. In the same way, your kes that have Amrit sprinkled into them, you don't want to just throw that away into the garbage. Because that's not respecting kes, which are, like I said, the Shiromani Anga of Gursikh, the highest arm. Another thing I wanted to talk about, actually, what I do. This is totally off topic, but it's a good time to pitch what I do. Like Gurdit Singh said, and Gurdit Singh is also involved, we're with the World Sikh Organization of Canada. Essentially, we work on three things. One is legal, which means if someone has a problem at work or with kakars or bullying, we can help with that. Second is media. If there's like an issue in the media with regards to Sikhs, we try and do a good job presenting a Sikh point of view. And the third is education, which means going to schools or going to politicians or workplaces and helping there. We are looking for young people to help us out. For example, we're doing a Canada-wide study on bullying. I've gotten a good response from Ontario, but I need some help here in BC anyways. So if you think you can get some young people to fill out a survey on bullying, which will go towards a Canada-wide survey, that would be helpful. If you think that you'd like to volunteer, and sometimes we've done internships for like credit at universities, or just in general, it'll help your resume, please get in touch with us. We have all kinds of projects that you can get involved with regards to Sikhi, with regards to legal issues, with regards to human rights issues. So that's something I wanted to talk about, yeah.
Do you guys have a Vancouver office?
Gurdit Singh is our Vancouver office. He's our vice president for British Columbia. So we have a number of volunteers here. There's no like formal office, but we do have a team here.
So just a walking office,
just go up there. You can visit the website worldsick.ca or worldsick.org.
And you can find us on Facebook as well.
Yeah. Oh.
Like I said, you can't avoid it, guys.
The World Sick Organization.
I'll message you.
And Twitter.
Anything else?
Jeevan Damanor.
Any other questions, Paisa?
Sorry, I just want to go back to the topic again. Sikhs nowadays, practicing Sikhs, do you think? I was going to say what I think, but I'll just ask you what you think. Do you think they are getting very ritualistic? We practice Rad Shriyadha in many forms, and do you think that we are moving towards being very ritualistic in our practices?
Difficult question. If you lose the forest for the trees, like I said, that you forget what you're keeping that for, if you forget what you're doing something for, then that's wrong. But at the same time, just because a lot of people might not agree with what you're doing, might criticize what you're doing, that doesn't make something wrong. For example, if you're not eating at restaurants, or you're saying that I'm going to eat food cooked by Gursikhs, or you're saying that I'm going to wake up early in the morning, people will criticize you. That doesn't make it a ritual. It just means people don't understand it. If it has a meaning for you, and you realize that this is going to help me to go towards my goal of meeting Vaheguru, if you really genuinely think that, then that's not a ritual. But if you are just doing this for your own ego, and it's just like a gloss for you, it's not really anything meaningful, it just helps you sort of carry on, then that's a ritual. But it's really a personal judgment. What's a ritual for me might not be a ritual for you. I mean, if I don't have any shardha for Guru Sahib, like politicians, and I go and Mathate, it doesn't mean anything for that politician. It's just a ritual. He's just following what he's been told to do. But for me, if I'm matha taking, it doesn't mean it's a ritual for me. It means I'm actually submitting myself to Guru Sahib, right? So what's a ritual for one person might not necessarily be a ritual for another.
Haan ji, dekha janda Khandpur Sahib bahut qurban de marg te vyah te sukh liya tode de bare ki chal jugo sunda ta.
We can't hear the question back.
Devinder Singh asked, a lot of Akhandparts are happening for births, deaths, everything. What do you think about that?
First off, the ritualistic aspect. Right?
Akhand parts are good. Akhand parts were a big deal back in the day. Gursikhs, when they you know, were in the forest when they couldn't actually have time to get together. Kanparts were like big smogons for them. It was a big deal when you read Guru Granth Sahib from start to finish in 48 hours. So if you do it that way, then a Kanparth is not a ritual. But if you do it in a way that, oh, I'm going to go for the start, the parties are going to do it, and then I'll go for the pog, and that's a ritual. Or if you go to some gurdwara where you actually can buy ready-made akhand parts and they're just going to suna the pog to you or something, that's also a ritual. Once again, it's your own shraddha, right? It's your own shraddha.
Can you give some practical advice for people getting bana that don't live in sick, rich cities?
Getting bana. Yeah, you have to find a tailor or online. There's some places where you can buy it. Satya Sauda in Brampton, I know, has a lot of bana. But, I mean, if you don't know of a tailor in your local area, I'd probably search the internet.
Sikhishop.com, is it? Sikhishop.com, I think.
So Manveer Singh says Sikhishop.com.
It's not America, the website.
So it might be expensive or whatnot, but if you go to India or Punjab, you can find a lot of shops that actually you can have your bana sewed. Whenever I go, I usually have a lot of stuff prepared for myself. It's cheaper, actually, even.
So you can order in India, get it in 2 weeks.
Yeah, I think even some of the shops, like one of the big ones is the Gulati outside of the Barsab. Like, you can even call that guy up and he'll, like, take your order and he'll ship it to you. So, that's a suggestion. I know he has an email address.
Any other questions?
Yep.
Is there wrong to wear 2 kashare?
I don't think there's a rat issue involved there. If you feel like wearing 2 kashare, go for it. Yeah.
Who's gonna see it?
Maybe there's some sort of a basis for that Paisab saying that. I'm not aware of any reason why when you die you should wear 2 kashare. But I mean, whatever. As an interesting sort of side note, there's a talk about kashare. There's actually kashare were very big when Sikhs went into battle back in the day. There's a good Sikh called Baba Ajay Pal Singh. And his data is still around. And his kashara, it's preserved there. But there's a picture of it. And there's like one person standing here, and one person at least standing by that pole probably. And the reason for that was that it gives you bulk around your legs, and it's sort of like protection in itself. But just an interesting note about kashara. Yeah.
How
did he manage the nara?
No idea.
Swabhaja, three people asked me why do Guru Sikhs wear 2 kripana? Ek shoti kripana hai, tapai te vibadi, why is it, and if you could explain that.
Why do some Guru Sikhs wear 2 kripans?
One underneath their clothes. Uh-huh.
It's like a personal preference. I mean, I think everyone has a reason for it. One karpan is like, for me, I wear 2 karpans when I'm out in the open. Like, this is my big one. And then I have a smaller one underneath. The smaller one is my kakad that I would sleep in, that I would bathe in. The bigger one is, it's like a formal sort of thing. You know, you have like formal wear. So that's my answer for it. Other Gosikhs might have different answers for it.
I think sometimes especially I don't experience it in Canada, but in America, when you go shopping and stuff, like when you're at a program and you go from the Gurdwara, a lot of Sikhs, you can't, it's
concealed up.
Yeah, it's you can't wear it on the outside because it gives you a lot of problems. So a lot of Sikhs in the States wear one underneath, so if they need to take it off from the outside, they have one underneath just so they don't get stuck without a karpan, like they don't get stuck inside. That's what some people do too.
You need one, you can wear as many as you'd like. I mean,
any other questions?
Okay, thank you very much, Vaheguru Ka Khalsa.
Oh, Panji, the questions you want.
I had a question with Amrit, because it's just like, it's something I want to do sometime in this lifetime, but it's like, I've been walking this path really slowly, and it's just like, I don't feel ready. And it's like, I'm like, are you ever going to feel ready to, like, flip it off?
Are you ever going to feel worthy of Amrit? That's, I think, the question. And the answer to that is, I don't think so. Because Amrit is something, it's priceless. You can never be worthy of it. Yes, the best you could do is say that whatever Guru Sahib says to me, whatever, like, I talked about Rath, right? And there's a saying, Gursikhi says, Pratham Rath Ye Jaan, Khande Ki Pahul Chake. That the first Rath, if you want to start following Rath, is Shaking Amrit. Because that's from all the rest of spirituality flows. Because you need Naam to jump Naam. And when you shak Amrit, the Panch Pyare actually plant Naam within you. And then you can jump Naam. It's a different experience. But the best you can do before you shak Amrit is this, that you say to yourself, whatever Guru Sahib says, whatever the rats there are, the Guru Sahib has ordered, I will follow that and make it a part of my life, and I won't question it. That I'm willing to submit myself to Guru Sahib. That I trust Guru Sahib 100%, and if you do that, Guru Sahib will help you along the way. No one's perfect when you shak Amrit. You'll have mistakes that you make, and that's fine. But making that commitment is the first step towards living that spiritual lifestyle. And if you wait for hours and hours and days and months and years, time just keeps passing. For me, what inspired me was, Amrit was like some weird concept that, oh, I didn't think I could do it. But I have a cousin who's very bold. Like, he'll do all kinds of things and very bold. He shaked Amrit at 15. And I was like, well, if he can do it, why can't I, right? But my personality is always a little bit reserved, but I don't think he'll ever be like, yes, I'm ready today to shaked Amrit. Just ready to make that commitment. So.
Any other questions?
Right over here, yeah.
Yeah.
So, I was wondering, would you be willing to speak more about your experience with the World Health Organization, particularly with, like, with your fund,
sure. A lot of my experience has been that explaining the Kirpan to Westerners, non-Sikhs, is one challenge. Explaining the Kirpan to Punjabi folk, explaining the way I look to Punjabi folk, that's a challenge in itself. So that case is actually ongoing. We've tried to negotiate it. If you don't know, I went to the Quebec National Assembly with a team of young Gursikhs, four of us, to talk about the niqab, which is the face covering, and we were told we couldn't go in with our kirpans. So we tried to negotiate a solution, didn't work out, so now the next step will be legal action, which we've already initiated. We'll see how that goes. What can you do to support us? Volunteer. There's so many projects that the Sikh community needs done today in terms of just awareness, in terms of putting a face to the Sikh community. Like, my face, like, I'll be very honest with you, I scare people. Like, if someone looks at me, they're gonna be, oh, that reminds me of, you know, a terrorist or something like that. And it's not right, but it's just the reality of it. But if I'm saying one thing, and there's a young woman saying the exact same thing, most people would be more receptive to a young woman saying it. So, if you wanna know how you can help, volunteer. There's so many things that you can talk about that I can talk about, and it won't be as openly received as it is if you talk about it. Even for young Gursikhs, most people, when they hear me talk, they're like waiting for the accent, and when it doesn't come, it's a surprise to them. So most of us here, we don't have accents, and even if you do, it doesn't matter. But surprise people that you're not some sort of a backward, sort of regressive Taliban type person, that, you know, you're a modern, that you're educated, that you know what's going on. It's a surprise, and most people haven't dealt with Sikhs, and if you deal with non-Sikhs, that's probably the first step. If you meet someone and you're telling them about Sikhi for the first time, that'll make a difference in their lives. It's harder for you to hate something that you actually know. So that's my suggestion to you.
Banji.
Like, in terms of, like,
ask yourself. That's a question that you can answer yourself. If you feel confident eating a certain type of food, that's up to you. I'll give you a brief example. There's a very large gurdwara on the east side of Canada. I'm not going to give its name, but the person that prepares the deg there is a Radha Swami. When he's making the deg, people around him know that he reads like Radha Swami mantras. And that's like Oankar, Arankar, Soang, Satnam. It's a whole mantra that they recite. And he's doing this, and he's an employed person. And if someone doesn't feel comfortable eating that so-called prasad, I don't fault them for it, right? Because that person doesn't have any shraddha, it's his job. And he's obviously reading something anti-Sikh while preparing it. It's your own shraddha if you want to eat something or not. And different people have different levels that they want to keep, and that's like an individual decision. I personally eat my food in Sarvlo. It's a decision I've made, and I feel it's a rat that I'd like to keep. But each person has the freedom to do the research, to make their own decisions, and do what they feel comfortable with. If you want to discuss any of that, I'm more than happy to do it on like a one-on-one basis and maybe tell you about my experiences, why I made the decisions I made.
I think...